booth?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so tell me where y'all come from.
Well, we live in Foxwoods right now. My heritage is from Baton Rouge.
Baton Rouge? You grew up around Baton Rouge?
Kind of, sort of. Not too much.
Okay, tell me about the kind of, sort of.
Well, not really. My people were there when I was a small child. I moved back to Columbia.
Columbia, okay. And Debbie?
I'm from Florida.
Florida, okay. You've got a beautiful voice and a beautiful anointing.
Yes.
It was beautiful. And that last song you sang is what I've been preaching for that. I started last September preaching on glory. And I've been preaching what you sang in that last song, which was so beautiful. With a name like LaBoo, I'm thinking down the bayou.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what I was thinking. That you have heritage from down the bayou. And Lord has brought you forth with your gift. And it's tremendous, a tremendous gift. And it's like he's brought you forth slowly, but now there's going to be another shooting forth. And he's going to shoot your gift out. You're living here now?
Yeah, we're in Columbia.
Columbia, okay, in this area. You're going to be given great favor. And you're, okay, I'll put it this way. Heaven has called your name.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Wow.
Heaven has called your name. Yes. Mm-hmm. And your name has been called forth. And you're going to be called, and he's going to start bringing your gift forth.
Mm-hmm.
Praise
Amen.
God.
Yes.
Woo.
Amen.
Bear witness
Amen.
To that.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
What we've been
waiting for. Amen. Before I start preaching, I do want to tell you, especially in view of the fact that our president is headed to Asia. I guess it was 2 weeks ago, Sandra, something like that. The Lord gave me a dream, and I may have posted it on Facebook, that the dragon and the Illuminati had called out an assignment against Trump to take him out. That was my dream. I'm very familiar with the Illuminati. The Lord's been speaking to me about the Illuminati for years and years and years. He'll just give me words here and there about them. And the dragon, I had to look it up. But if I searched, of course, we know about the dragon in the Bible, but I knew this was a power and principality. And it was a two-horned dragon. It comes out of China. But then if you just search out North Korea and South Korea, the dragons that are over North Korea and South Korea come out of China. So let's pray right now. If the Lord gave me that, he wants me to pray about it. So wherever I go, I pray about that and break off that power, the dragon, which is that power and principality, has joined forces with the Illuminati to take him out. So let's pray and break that, which I've been doing regularly since God gave that to me, if you would join with me. If you pray in tongues, please go ahead. Lord Jesus, we just break off this assignment of the powers and principalities of the dragon and of the Illuminati who have conspired together to bring down the President of the United States. And Lord, I pray, Lord, that you will expose the people that is far behind this, both in the Illuminati and both in those dragon nations. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Then there was another mini vision that I had where I saw Jesus was like in an apothecary shop. And he was taking pieces of this and this and this and this. And he was putting them on scales of justice. And they had gotten to the right place on scales of justice. And Jesus tipped the scales of justice.
Yes.
And so we have been seeing justice come forth in all kinds of areas that we know justice needs to come forth. So even in some of your areas where you have not received justice and where someone has done you wrong or done you bad or you haven't yet received your justice, you're also going to see justice move for you. in your life. And, well, I'll talk about something else here in a minute. I want to get on with this message about prosperity that God gave me. And I know this is not any message that's new to this church, Pat, but it's one that God gave me. Mm-hmm. While I was preaching on the glory, and at different seasons of my life, I would hear the Lord speak to me. Carolyn, I'm taking you into another level of my prosperity. I wasn't sure what that would look like. But I knew that whatever it was, it would be good. If God took me into another level of prosperity. And each time I heard this in my spirit, I would begin to experience new levels of prosperity in different areas of my life. And when I say different areas of prosperity, that didn't mean necessarily my bank account. Financial worry or concerns were no longer relevant to my thought process. I wasn't sitting around thinking about how I was going to make ends meet or pay the bills. Or how I was going to meet whatever financial obligations I had. It was taken care of.
That's right.
Even though you couldn't see it. Peace concerning my future and my present financial security. I was at peace at my age, 77. I've never missed a meal. I've always had a roof over my head. I've never had a bill I couldn't pay. In my whole life, I've never had a bill I couldn't pay. Now you tell me that's prosperity. Mm-hmm. Okay, if God has done that for me for 77 years, don't you think He's going to finish me out? Peace concerning the support of the church and our special meetings that we have. No indebtedness. Seeing my children and church family prosper financially, emotionally, and spiritually. Walking in a place of wherever there was a financial need in my life or in the ministry was met when the need presented itself. That's prosperity. Good health. No doctor bills. My clothes and shoes never wear out. I mean, as a matter of fact, I got whole closets full. And they never wear out. My hands are always full with blessings for others. My bank account is never empty.
That's right. Come on.
The church's bank account is never empty.
Amen.
Doors of favor continue to open with goodness and goodwill wherever I go. At my conferences, I would tell people I have two angels on either side of me. One is called goodness, and the other one's called favor. Blessing and favor. I have two angels, blessing and favor. Wherever I go, blessing and favor go with me. They're two angels. They're yours. Bible says so. There's nothing I have need of. I'm not boasting. I'm talking to you about God's prosperity.
That's right.
Come on.
Amen.
I'm talking about a state of mind. A state of being. I'm happy and I'm content in who I am in Christ Jesus. I don't need to be someone else. I'm happy in my own skin. I like who God made me. God and I are happy together in our relationship with each other. That's all He wants from us, you know. That's the reason you were created, was to have fellowship. He wants us to just have fellowship with Him. And in the having fellowship with Him, a ministry will come forth. You've heard me tell my story about when I started the church in Baton Rouge. It was an accident. I was in fellowship with the Lord, and I was ministering with the Lord, and a church started. I was the most surprised person in the world that we had a church. But it came out of fellowship with Him. And then when I moved to Texas, and the Lord had told me to start a church, but I was seeking Him for the church, and He rebuked me. He said, "Don't seek me for the church, Carolyn, seek me." And I want to tell you about this location. This is a new beginning. And this is a good location. This is good crowd for the first meeting, and if nobody even knows where it is or how to find it, and you're here, this is a good crowd. Because God is going to begin to plant you here. And as you're planted here, there is going to come forth a harvest from the planting that project be coming forth from here. Lord says, I have sent you out as one who was sent out. And Lord says, even though the brook may seem to dry up in one area, says the Lord, then I send you on to the next area. And if the brook dries up, it doesn't stop you, says the Lord, because you're called to plant. And so shall you go forth, and you shall keep planting, and you shall keep planting, and you shall keep planting into whatever area you're sent into. And even as I've called you as an apostle of deliverance, saith the Lord, so shall deliverance come forth into that area that I send you into. Because I have set you as an apostle of deliverance, and I will send you to those people, saith the Lord. And it will be into those areas you shall go. And as I'm talking about prosperity, and Pat, God has given Pat prosperity. I tried to list all of them, I couldn't. And the thing of it is, I had never shared this before until I shared it a couple of weeks ago in this light, just like this. I'd never shared it before. It never occurred to me. I just knew it. It was, you know, some things, you know things with God, but you don't talk about them. Because it never occurs to you to talk about them. You just know these things. But it was, we had Gerald McManus was there a couple weeks ago. And his son-in-law came up to the front for me to minister to him. And just like that, the Spirit of God says, I want you to lay hands on him and tell him that I am bringing him into a new level of my prosperity. So I said, okay, and then Daryl stood up, he wanted his tonight, so, you know, we went on around here,
no, he's
and,
good.
Yeah, he's good,
yeah.
And so I began to prophesy, and then that evening, now mind you, I'd never done it like this before, it just hit, just like that, so that evening when we were having our gathering at my house, I did it again, I sealed it on the people that were there that evening. It was a sealing. It went to a different level than it did that morning. I sealed them into a new level of God's prosperity. So then I thought, well, I best go ahead and teach on this, which I'd never done before. So then I asked myself, what is the key to the kingdom that releases us into greater levels of God's prosperity? We all want God's prosperity.
Amen.
Because in God's prosperity is joy forevermore.
Mm-hmm.
So as I put some things together, I know of my own life, just pondering my own life. Obedience and following the Lord's heart is all I know.
That's right.
We know we go from faith to faith and from glory to glory. And in the Lord's glory is our prosperity. In that, however much glory we can carry is how much prosperity we can carry. How much glory can you carry? Pat and I were around, and I'm going to talk about it in a few minutes, around 2000, when God's glory was moving so powerfully in so many ministers, but they couldn't carry it. And many of them fell. They couldn't carry it, but God's raising them up again. You see, God gives us another chance. So I said, what is prosperity? Godliness and contentment is great gain. I used to know this lady, and she was a very unhappy woman, and she was just screaming and crying all the time, and she wanted this, something else. And I said, well, I told her, I prophesied to her, and I said, God wants to give you peace. She says, I need everything else in the world but peace.
Oh, wow.
No, let me tell you something. If you've got God's peace, you've got everything in the world.
That's right.
If you have God's peace, you have everything in the world. You're not screaming and yelling about anything. And as Christians, we know we're just tithe and need givers. I do not preach or put our congregation under the curse of the tithe, and I tell my congregation not to sit under it. We're under the blessing of the tithe, because every Old Testament curse was broken at the cross. When we appropriate, we have to appropriate. It's not automatic.
That's right.
By faith, the Holy Spirit of God and the blood of Jesus, read Galatians. And so I considered some more, and I realized that the Lord sent his angel with Abraham's servant to prosper his way to find a wife for Isaac. The Lord had already prospered Abraham in every way, the Bible says. That's a quote, direct quote from the Bible. God had prospered Abraham in every way. So we can, and that he told him that he sent angels to get a wife for Isaac. Okay, so we can say that the Lord sends his angels to bless us with prosperity. Like I said, I have goodness, I have blessings and favor standing beside me all the time. There is an angel of prosperity.
Amen.
How do I know this? It says this in the Bible. That Abraham, with these angels were sent forth, the Lord to, so we can say that the Lord sends forth his angels to bless us with prosperity. The Lord sent his angel with Abraham's servant to prosper his way.
Hmm. Yeah.
There is an angel of prosperity.
Yes.
Who is sent into your life,
yes,
to give you prosperity.
Amen.
So when the Lord had me seal that on that group that was there that Sunday night, he was sealing on them that an angel of prosperity, when God places his seal on a matter, it is sealed under his sovereign will.
Yes, yes, yes.
He sealed them into prosperity.
Hmm.
Is this good?
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
And y'all may remember this because I came here and I preached the $10,000 blessings, and we're probably going to lose a few tonight. Yeah, some of you got some. Some of you got some. $10,000 blessings, right? That was May the 1st, 2011. And you can ask my church, I don't preach on prosperity that often. I preach on the glory all the time. But on May the 1st, 2011, the Lord told me to speak and declare prosperity and financial blessings to his people. But even before that, the Lord was having me release $10,000 blessings to people when he would tell me. Okay, so now that I have figured this thing out, that there's an angel of prosperity, that it must have been assigned to me or I couldn't declare it, right?
That's right.
There has to be an angel of prosperity that has been released into the ministry, or I couldn't go into a ministry and release that prosperity into people's lives. How many of you want an angel of prosperity?
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Praise God. So, I had looked up Dave's commentary because I'm searching this thing out now. Now, for years and years, God has told me he's going to take me into different levels of prosperity, but I never searched out what he was telling me until a couple weeks ago. So, I found seven laws of prosperity in Dave's commentary. God with man. The Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man. Jeremiah 20:11, the Lord protected Jeremiah from his persecutors, and the Lord prospered him in his way. Now I don't, and that scripture goes on to say that the Lord is with me as a mighty, terrible one. Therefore, my persecutors shall stumble, and they shall not prevail. That's prosperity. Okay. Because we're not to give place to our persecutors. Now, I don't want my persecutors punished. Like I said, I've forgotten who they were. I've even forgotten. That's prosperity. I can't even remember who don't like me. I can't even remember what they did to me. And I can't remember why they don't like me. That's prosperity.
Amen.
Great peace have they which love your law, and nothing shall offend them. If we could ever get to the church, I preach on it all the time. Now, that's one of my hammers. I'm hammering my church all the time. Every time we have one of our conferences back, they get a lecture. If any one of them gets offended, Don't be coming and telling me about it. I don't want to hear about you getting offended.
Amen.
Well, every year somebody gets offended. But it's the level of their maturity.
Uh-oh.
It's the level of their maturity. I know where the immaturity is in the church when people get offended. What causes you to get offended? Your pride. But grace and peace are they which love your law, and nothing shall offend them. Prosperity. I probably need a time schedule on this because I probably got more to say than I got time here. Okay. Then next is obedience. Blessed is the nation who obeys and fears the Lord and does not go after other gods. And God will set that nation high above all other nations of the earth. And all the blessings that are listed in Deuteronomy 28 will overtake that nation. We know the days when our nation was blessed, and we know when our nation came under judgment, beginning with 9/11, and we saw our nation begin to go down. But now we have a president who stands for Christian values. He stands for God. I'm not saying his name is saint. I'm saying the hand of God is on him. And that because God's hand is on him, that he is anointed to do what God, because of the church's prayers. I mean, they're taking your statues. I call them the alien statue slayers. They're taking your statues and they're taking your history. That's what the Nazis did. They took your books, their statues, their art, everything that had to do with their history, and they destroyed them. And this is what they're doing in the United States of America. I call it what it is. Amen. Keep the charge of the Lord your God to walk in his ways, that you may prosper in all that you do and wherever you turn yourself. Goodness to Israel. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and they shall prosper that love you. If you get in a financial bind, just start praying for Jerusalem. And God has to honor his word. He sends, as you speak and proclaim the word of God, he sends angels to perform his spoken word. Meditation. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. You shall meditate on it day and night. But you shall meditate therein day and night, that you may prosper wherever you go. In the book of Psalms, I don't list down the scriptures, but it's in there. Live godly. Put your trust in God. Have sins forgiven. Free from imputed sin. What is imputed sin? False accusations. Are you going to get down under because someone falsely accuses you? Well, you'll never be a prophet or an apostle if you're going to get upset when someone falsely accuses you. Because persecution and coming under false accusations is one of the things you're going to have to walk through.
Amen.
And not give it power or place. If you don't give it power or place, you're not going to let it touch you.
That's right. Amen.
You don't be going around saying somebody did somebody wrong. So you're not going to let that thing touch you. When the Bible says it can't come near you, that means you don't give it place. Help the poor. Live in God's house. Draw strength from God. Worship God. Allow God to chasten you. Don't run from God's correction. When God corrects you, you receive it. God ever corrected you and you tried to hide your sin because you wanted to keep it? Hide your sin and say, well, it's okay. You know, I'm just, this is not too big, bad of a sin. That's not what God really means. And no repentance. Fear God. Live undefiled lives. Obey God's word. Walk in wisdom. Hear wisdom. And wait upon the Lord. And then there's faith. They rose early in the morning and went forth into the wilderness of Tekoa. And as they went forth, Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe his prophets, so shall you prosper. Christian, you've got to be established. When Pat came to Hattiesburg, she had to be established. And you've got to believe the God's prophets, so you won't prosper. Every time I receive a word of the Lord from one of God's powerful prophets, and I know who they are. Some of them are dying off too soon. So all these powerful prophets from my generation that were before me, they're dying off. And I'm not seeing that anointing that they're carrying falling on the younger generation. Now, I know that they're going to have an anointing for their generation, but they're not carrying what Stanley Wright can carry. They're not carrying what Roger Till carries. They're not carrying what some of these prophets carry that are so powerful, and they're dying off. But let me tell you, when I had one of them speak into my life, it meant there was something it was going to cost me that I was going to have to lay down to receive the greater blessing that God had for me.
What's wrong?
I was going to have to change something in my life. When the subtleties of God come into your life, that means you've got to move suddenly.
Amen.
If God is moving suddenly and you don't move suddenly with him, you're going to miss him.
Yeah.
Amen. The Lord will prosper us in that which he sends us into. We must have faith in him, not the circumstances surrounding us. Circumstances do not mean a thing. What really matters is what's the spirit, what is going on in the spirit, and it may not yet have broken forth to what God is going to do, but you're going to have to be faithful and not be weary in well-doing. That means you keep doing what God has sent you to doing until it changes. It's not for the reward that we labor, but for his glory, our love for him and his kingdom. The glory of his kingdom is more awesome than any earthly reward. Yet the glory of heaven and our inheritance is poured upon us as we rest in him and live in him and rejoice in his glory. Our only motive can be seeking the Lord himself. If you have any other motive, you need to get right with God and his kingdom purposes. We do not seek after prosperity or ministry. We seek him. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
Yes.
And all these things shall be added unto you. Oh, that's the first message I ever preached. Never changed it. In 2 Chronicles 26:5, Uzziah, king of Israel, sought God in the days of Zechariah, who had understanding in the visions of God. As long as he sought the Lord, God made him to prosper.
Yes.
Okay, so we get up with a problem and we go want to go try to fix it. Or do we seek the Lord? Mm-hmm. Do we just seek the Lord? And then some churches are just fix-it people. They're going to fix it. Well, we don't have a fix-it ministry in our church. We don't. We seek the Lord and ask him what he wants to do about it. And then there's hospitality. Give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Pressed down and shaken together. And running over shall men give into your bosom. For with the same measure that you give, it shall be measured to you again. Never outgive God. You never will outgive him. Christians who love the Lord will always delight to be givers.
Amen.
It's a great grace on our hearts to have a giving heart and to be free-hearted. And being free-hearted means also that we forgive easily. We don't hold grudges. Mm-hmm. We don't have to have the last word. Mm-hmm. We don't have to get the last slug in.
Come on. Come on now.
One of the ways to deposit the grace of giving into those who are needy and have a needy soul is to give to them. Maybe they never had anyone give to them. Now you know when it's time to cut it off. The joy of receiving will grace them in return with the joy of giving. Many have not grown up in a family where love and blessings abound. If the only deposit they had in their lives were greed, covetousness, lack, and need, that's all they know. Mm-hmm. Bitterness. When we give and forget we gave, we're making deposits of abundance into needy hearts. Will some take advantage? Yes. But we will soon know those who are grateful and those whose hearts are filled with iniquity. And when I saw that scale of justice be turned over, I saw God, that meant that the sin, that iniquity had become full. Daryl pointed out when he was there the difference between sin and the difference between iniquity. He said, we can be forgiven our sin, but never give up our iniquity. And when our cup of iniquity gets full, we will be judged. The Lord also warns us of backsliding in prosperity. When you have eaten and are full, then you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land which he has given you. Beware that you do not forget the Lord your God in not keeping his commandments, his judgments, and his statutes. Lest when you have eaten and are full, that you build goodly houses and dwell therein. When your herds and your flocks multiply, your silver and gold is multiplied, and your heart be lifted up, and you forget the Lord your God. We've been in ministry long enough, Pat, to know. I have seen them come in, and they'll be at the bottom of the dung heap trying to dig out. And if you stay under the anointing for 2 years with God, I can promise you your life is going to change. If you stay under that anointing for 2 years, God will, whatever situation you were in, if you stay there, God's going to change your life in 2 years. And I have seen people come in at the bottom of the dung heap, come into the realm of prosperity, and when they got into that prosperity, they forgot God. Mm-hmm. Some of those people are dead now. Mm-hmm. The grateful heart that God desires from us. And just as we delight to bless our children, don't you love to bless your children? Don't you love to be a blessing? He delights to bless us even more. He has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, it says in Psalm 35:27. He will send you an angel of prosperity to prosper you. And then he will take pleasure in your prosperity.
Yes.
It says so in the Bible.
That's right.
I've been young and now I'm old. Yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his descendants begging for bread. This is a promise that God has to every Christian. Your descendants will not have to beg for bread. That's a promise. When I was growing up in Southeast Missouri on the farm, I was a pretty smart kid. I looked around me, and I saw the Christians who went to church every Sunday, and I saw how prosperous they were as compared to those who did not go to church. Just as we're grieved when people are ungrateful, grieves the Lord when Christians murmur, complain, poor mouth, mooch, become freeloaders, or refuse to work. There are ministries who will never come to our church because they come with one motive, that's to fleece the sheep. They may come one time, but they won't come back. These are wolves who do not trust the Lord for provisions for their gifts and callings. I can tell you right now, to you TV preachers out there, if you have to get on television and beg for money, you're not walking in God's prosperity. God did not give you the ministry of a beggar because God's children are not beggars.
That's right. Come on, that's good.
The same is true of a hireling. These only labor for their wages. And yes, if we're the one paying the wages, we better be fair, and we must be fair. The owner of the vineyard will always pay the workers before the owners receive any reward for their labor. My father was a farmer. He owned a farm. And I have seen him make sure all the laborers at harvest time got paid, even if it looked like he wasn't going to have a nickel left over. He made sure the laborers got paid first. And would we do any less than that in the ministry?
Amen.
The owner of the vineyard has to have their trust in the Lord to be their reward. Perhaps that's another key to the many levels of God's prosperity. He is our shield and He is our great reward. The Lord repays our work with a full reward. The pastor's appreciation, Jenna Nastily gave me one of her treasured books, Mystery of the Glory Unveiled by David Herzog. Didn't you mention David to me?
Yeah.
I think he's up in his 70s now, and I haven't really kept up with his ministry, but this book ministered to me. And the book is a chronicle of the Golden Glory Revival, and we've all been in it, and still some of it, like Clay Nash was at our place recently, and I mean the glory drip, praise God.
Yes.
But it was in late 1998, 2000, at the turn of the millennium. Everybody was looking for what God was going to doing at the millennium, and He was releasing that Golden Glory Revival all over for those that would see it. That's what God did at the millennium. And the book was first published in the year 2000, and I'm just going to speak briefly about it. I'm not going to say too much about it, but the Lord spoke to Brother Hosog to expect three new signs, and that was when he started that, of what the glory would be like for the next year. And the first one was the gold dust at Ruth Ward Heflin's. And God did miracles of healing for those in attendance, and prophetic words were given for the camp and for His ministry. And then He left for Vancouver of Europe, and He said the spirit of holiness pervaded the meetings, and many began to weep before the Lord. They searched their hearts, and the Holy Spirit exposed hidden motives, bitterness, rejection, and other obstacles to walking in the glory of God. If you give these things residue in your heart, it is going to be an obstacle to you walking in His glory. And then he said he knew that he was experiencing revival because there was a new wave of unusual miracles. It's easy to miss a new move of God or to be offended. That's why it's so important, Christian, not to be offended. Because as each new move comes, it happens largely because revival takes on a different form each time it comes. The new move of God will have many characteristics of previous revivals, but it also have a new elements of glory. And those who are ready to receive it will receive it, and those who will not will reject it. We had this amazing move of God that came in 1998-2000 when the Golden Glory was released throughout the city, throughout the church, but only a few received it. The second sign was the gold filling of teeth. He said it was in Amsterdam. Just saying, now I've never witnessed someone receiving a gold crown on their teeth. Pat has. I never have. But I have one witnessed the Golden Glory, and it's so magnificently on Clay Nash. That if the Lord reveals Himself in one miracle, who am I to say He won't do it with teeth being filled? Now, as I told him, as for me, I don't really need a gold tooth. I mean, I wouldn't be something I'd think about. But I sure could use some bone down here. As I'm aging, I'm losing bone. And there's some more areas that I could use some replacement valves on.
Come on.
And then he talks about the third sign. And he went to this conference, and as the speaker ministered, people got up out of their seats and began to surge forward, laying money on the altar and the pulpit. With an outpouring of spontaneous giving. Have y'all seen that happen?
I have.
Yeah. And just as the people spontaneously laid their offerings at the apostles' feet, this phenomena happened again. And of course, at first he was like, well, hey, that guy's got plenty of money. He doesn't need all that money. Why's all those people giving him all that money? So finally he gave, and then he got opened up three television ministries for him after that. Mm. But this was the same spirit of giving that had possessed the earlier followers of Christ. As they gave, the power of God was turned on in their lives. Suddenly they had all things in common. That means the same power that was on the apostles was on the people.
Amen.
By great power, the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Great grace was upon them all. Spontaneous giving released an atmosphere for signs, wonders, and miracles, and allows a person to partake of a grace working in someone else's ministry. For those ministries who beg, manipulate, or coerce people to give to them, you're not operating in God's prosperity. I will say this to you, and I will declare it to you. I'm speaking to the internet out there, because that's not anyone in this room. When I'm speaking like this, my church always tells me it's those folks out in that internet, it's not for them. If you are having to manipulate people, coerce people, or you're having to beg, is that God's prosperity? No, you're operating out of your own lack of faith and fear. Through the wave of signs and wonders and moves of God at the time of the new millennium, the Lord released a new wave of wisdom, revelation, and knowledge. Through the internet, in the past 17 years, our church, we've witnessed the knowledge of the glory of the Lord filling the whole earth as the waters cover the sea. Yes. The knowledge of the glory of the Lord is the gospel of Jesus Christ.
That's right. Come on.
And we have come to the place that the Lord gave me a vision. I probably shared it here because I share it everywhere. I was standing on top of the tallest mountain on the whole earth. This was probably back in the 1980s. I had a dove on my shoulder. And with my heaven, I could say, heaven is at hand. And I saw waves and waves of glory cover the lower mountains and the higher mountains. And then it picked me up and took me to glory. So that was before Facebook. That was before the internet streaming. Back then, I mean, there was television, but I knew that in my lifetime, I was going to see that. Pat, I have seen it.
Glory.
I have seen it through streaming on websites, through the Facebook, the knowledge of the gospel, which is the glory of God, cover the whole earth. And people who have not received it, because if they look up into heaven, the heavens will declare the glory of God. The heavens speak and declare the glory of God to all people. Okay, I'm winding down here in a second. Y'all tired yet?
No.
We've witnessed the restoration of the prophetic revelation movement the past 30 years in our lifetime, Pat. We used to go to churches, and only two or three people could get prophecy. Everybody couldn't get a prophecy. We witnessed the miracles of the kingdom of God, men connected as one throughout the internet. I literally have people from all over the world contact me every week.
That's right.
From every nation. When the glory of heaven and earth collide, supernatural provisions come. Our new levels of God's prosperity, as he spoke it to me. As we go from glory to glory, we will also go into levels of prosperity. I'm now persuaded that whatever level of glory we're walking in will coincide with the level of God's prosperity. We will walk in God's economy and make withdrawals as we're about his business. I tell people I have certificates of deposit in heaven. If you go in to see a financial advisor, he only wants to start with $500,000. If you don't have $500,000, he won't even start your planning. And even $1 million now, I'm going to get some financial advisors to help you. You've got to have more than that. There will be no fear or lack. So I can just tell you, my certificates are positive for in heaven. Our future is secure. We have this confidence that our bank account is in heaven. We just keep walking in the wisdom of the Lord. Happy is the man who finds wisdom and the man who gains understanding. For her precepts were better than the profits of silver and her gain than fine gold. Wisdom and revelation knowledge are the keys to the miracle realm. You know how I know? Mark 6:2. Where did this man get these things? They said of Jesus. And what wisdom is this which is given to him that such mighty works are performed by his hands? I'm going to close with one more story. I put two messages together here because I got a whole bunch of messages. But I wanted to share this tonight, and tomorrow I'm going to be sharing the vision of the night I had of the glory of God. It was in late September, I guess. I was standing in an atmosphere of golden glory that was totally surrounded by glory. And I saw this cart come in with gold. Anyway, I'm going to be sharing about that tomorrow. But I want to share this little bit first before I close it down. There are many metaphors of the glory of Christ in the Old Testament as well as the New. And they all reveal different facets of God's glory, and we can just keep on preaching it forever and never reach all of them. He is the rose of Sharon, the sweet perfume of his love, grace, and obedience. He is the lily for the beauty of his grace and love. In the New Testament, he's called the pearl of great price because he is precious to the brethren. He's called the vine for his fruitfulness. He's called the lamb for his meekness and fitness for sacrifice. This example that I'm going to use is the glory of Christ in mystical union with his church. This union corresponds to all the real or moral unions between persons or things. Such is the union between the head of a body and its members. Are the vine and its branches, which is real, or between a husband and wife, which is moral and real? God established man in his image. In his image, the Bible says he created male and female. The only way that we can recreate in God's image is in the image of male and female. As the head and husband of the church, Christ became responsible for all the debts incurred by his wife. Now, would you let that sink in a minute? As the head of his church, as the husband of the church, Christ became responsible for all the debts incurred by his wife. He sanctified and saved her by his sufferings and the shedding of his blood on the cross. Now, whatever debt you have, whether it's financial, what are things that are unresolved in your life, when you became his bride, he took your debt. And that goes for you men, your brides too. The glory of Christ in this union is unique, and it is a mystery. I'm telling you, church, you're living below what God has provided. The church is living below what God has provided. He has given you an angel, and this may be an unemployed angel sitting over here waiting on you to send that angel out, and it's your prosperity angel. Sitting there unemployed because you don't know that you got a prosperity angel. Mm-hmm. It says in the book of Genesis. It says that God took all your debts. The mystical union with Christ with his church was only after he suffered for her, for it follows the conversion of men to him. It is by faith that we are united to him. And until that union with him has been wrought in us, we have no mystical union with him. He is not a head or husband to unregenerate, unsanctified unbelievers. And Christian, There are many Christians walking around out there who are not living a sanctified life. You may even go to church on Sunday. You might get up and prophesy. You might even get out in a bar and you can preach. But let me tell you, if you're not walking and trying to live a sanctified life before God, the inheritance of the bride is not yours.
That's right.
Amen.
Now, that doesn't mean any of us are going to be perfect. That just means we're trying, giving it what we got. And that was the state of the whole church when God, Christ, died for us. Unregenerate, unsanctified, unbelievers. Although this mystical union does not actually take place until believers are united to Christ, yet the church of the elect was chosen to be Christ's spouse before his sufferings in order that he might love her and suffer for her. We have the example of Jacob, who served Laban many years for a wife. Rachel did not become his wife until after he had served for her. By his service, he purchased her to be his wife. Yet while he's serving for her, she's called his wife because of his love for her and because she was a spouse to be his wife. So the church was to be the spouse of Christ in God's purpose. And so Christ loved her and gave himself for her. I'm jealous over you with a godly jealousy, for I have espoused you to one husband, that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. So in the work of redemption, it was the church which was to be redeemed, because she was to be the spouse of Christ. This made possible the actual union between Christ and his church. Behind all that Christ did and suffered for the church, there was a supreme act of the will of God the Father, giving all the elect to him, entrusting them to him to be redeemed, sanctified, and saved. On these grounds, this mystical union between Christ and his church was real before it actually came into being. There is also a federal union, a union formed by a treaty, a contract, or a covenant drawn up between the persons concerned. So the Lord Jesus Christ undertook to be the surety of the new covenant on behalf of the church. As surety, he gave himself to God to fulfill all the demands of the law and justice on behalf of the church. By reason of this federal union, it was just and right for God to impute our sins to Christ in his obedience and death to us, treating us as if we had obeyed and we had died for our own sins. So it is in this union that Christ is exceeding glorious and precious to believers. No heart can conceive or tongue express the glory of Christ in this union of Christ and the church. The glory of the church as the bride of Christ. One of the messages that I preached this week was the glory of the morning upon the mountains, and that is a metaphor of the glory of the coming forth in the bride of Christ. I didn't bring that message with me, but because of this union, Christ is glorious in the sight of God, angels, and men. In Christ, both the justice and mercy of God are glorified. By his cross, divine holiness and justice were exalted, and through his triumph, grace and mercy are poured out to the full. In this glory, our carnal soul will die, and our spirit man will live in eternal beauty and fullness. Christ is glorious in that perfect obedience to the law of God. This obedience was necessary to exalt the wisdom, holiness, and righteousness of God in giving the law. By virtue of this mystical union with the church, the law was perfectly obeyed in us, by being obeyed for us. Now the glory of God is giving the law and its promised rewards as seen in its perfection. Our view of Christ's glory by faith will scatter all fears, all poverty. There's no place for a spirit of poverty. Answers all objections, disperse all depression, all need, all temptations, all doubting souls. When he married us, he took on our debts. He said that he would rejoice with singing over us at our prosperity. He delights at our prosperity. He has sent an angel called Prosperity to bless his church. And we haven't even known that the angel, there was such an angel, because for a while, the church wouldn't even preach on the ministry of angels. So my prayer in closing is, Lord Jesus, take us from glory to glory, that we may behold you in the beauty of your holiness, and that we may live in your economy and in the glory of your of that prosperity all the days of our life. Mm-hmm. If it's okay, Pat, I'd like to seal that prosperity of